Hi, I'm Brendan Clark. Welcome back to Philosophy of Medicine. This is our fifth lecture in the series, and it's all about chronic fatigue syndrome. Now, the point of this lecture really is to try and set up a more theoretical discussion about definitions of disease. This is a question that's been of intense interest to many philosophers of medicine. But I worry about it, and I worry about it largely because often the kind of issues that get discussed don't seem to have very much to do with some very pressing and very practical problems about defining diseases that doctors encounter in, well, all kinds of clinical practice. The kind of questions that I'm interested in really is, well, what kind of counts as a disease? What sets of conditions count as a proper disease? And second of all, how do we distinguish those things that count as diseases from other things, right? The third question then is trying to think about why we do that. So thinking about why it might be important to call some states of affairs, and for those of you with more philosophy than most, like people who've read lots of Armstrong and so on, this isn't meant to be a kind of specific description, but why is it important maybe to call some states of affairs diseases? And fourth, who gets to decide what counts as a disease? As we'll see in this kind of case, it's very, very hard to resolve disputes about, for want of a better term, diseasehood. And it's hard, I think, to find a more pressing and urgent example than chronic fatigue syndrome. I also at this point would like to do a little bit of recapping, because I think there's some interesting kind of cross-cutting that happens here with the philosophical work that we talked about on discovery. And particularly I want to just briefly point at the work that we looked at the end of the previous lecture, which was Norwood Russell Hansen on discovery. And remember that Hansen gave us a kind of logical framework for thinking about discovery. And it is just a framework, right? It's not a particularly detailed, developed account. But it does give us some logical ways of thinking about discovery. and the point here is this, that really Hansen sets out kind of three steps in thinking about discovery logically. These are, in order, first of all, that we find some surprising phenomena, right? Some odd, unexpected things happen. We can then begin making sense of those surprising things by hypothesizing, some hypothesis, some H, that would be capable of explaining those phenomena. In fact, Hansen says that those phenomena would follow as a matter of course from something like H, our hypothesis, and will be explained by it. And the third step is then to think that there's a good reason for elaborating such a hypothesis, right? And proposing it as a possible assumption, basically, from which the kind of surprising phenomena that we run into might well be explained. Now, for Hansen, this was a matter really of getting philosophers to think about science in a better way, to really take seriously what happens in discovery when they do their philosophical work. The kind of slogan for this that we talked about last time was that Hansen says that we must attend as much to how scientific hypotheses are caught as to how they're cooked. And that kind of hunter-gatherer kind of story is what we're going to do today. We're going to think about where chronic fatigue syndrome comes from, how it was discovered. Now at this point I want to just pause and talk a bit about terminology. In this lecture I've got to use three bits of terminology to describe chronic fatigue. First of all, and most broadly, I'm going to use CFS/ME, as a kind of umbrella term. This is meant to be my most broad way, really, of referring to what I've been calling before chronic fatigue, so CFS/ME. I'll also use two more specific terms, which are CFS, chronic fatigue syndrome, and ME, that myalgic encephalopathy. And please, I hope that I won't have to say that again too many times. They have more narrow meanings, and later on in the lecture we'll give some definitions. But just for now, I'll use CFS-ME as a kind of umbrella term to talk about chronic fatigue. And note that I'm not kind of endorsing here any particular position on what CFS-ME is. And the point of doing that is not cowardice so much as these terms are deeply disputed, and I don't want to come down on one side or the other for the purposes of this lecture. Okay, so what's CFS-ME? Well, Simon Wesley's 1995 definition is a good place to begin. He says that CFS-ME is a condition of long-lasting post-exertional fatigue that's unrelieved by rest. That means that people with CFS-ME are typically tired. They're tired for a long time, it's long-lasting. The fatigue is post-exertional, so it gets worse after you exert yourself, after you do things. And it doesn't get better when you rest. Now, even just from that definition, you can see that this is not the kind of thing that people tend to complain of when maybe they've had a very busy day, been running about, or like I did at the beginning of this week, had to walk the 10 or so miles home from work because of public transport playing up. This is something very different, and this sounds intuitively, I think, like the kind of thing that we would tend to call or want to call a disease. We should also note that CFS-ME in this way, defined in this way rather, is pretty common. The estimates vary a bit, but the prevalence data for the UK suggests that something like 0.2 to 0.4% of the population are currently experiencing this kind of thing. So that means, you know, the order of several hundred thousand sufferers currently in the UK. And that's particularly important because this CFS-ME has a pretty poor prognosis in the sense that people who suffer this kind of condition seem to have great difficulty in shaking it off, and that causes all kinds of problems and limitations in work and other activities of daily living, as the clinicians say. So it's relatively common, and it causes prolonged and profound illness and disability. And it's quite widely known that this can have a very, very substantial impact on individuals and on their families. So it's serious. This is something that's worth taking seriously. Okay, so chronic fatigue syndrome is important clinically. But that's not to say that it's kind of well understood. And part of the reason for that is there are, this is so obvious that I'm sort of slightly embarrassed to be saying it, but lots of things make you tired, right? And it can be quite hard to unpick causes of tiredness. In fact, a very common complaint seen in general practice is people who complain of feeling excessively tired. Now, as a clinician, you might well run through a long list of things that can cause tiredness. Let me try and do this, and I might have to do this at high speed because it's a pretty long list. In fact, I'm reasonably confident that I will feel excessively tired by the time I've got to the end of it. But first of all, you can have
lifestyle factors. So alcohol use or excessive alcohol use, excessive caffeine use paradoxically can make you tired. Excessive physical activity, like my 10-mile walk earlier this week. Inactivity can cause you tired, can cause you to feel tired. Lack of sleep can fairly obviously cause you to be tired. Many medications like antidepressants and antihistamines and cough medicines can cause you to feel tired. Unhealthy eating and poor diet can certainly make you feel tired. Outside of lifestyle factors, lots of psychological conditions cause tiredness. It's a commonly encountered symptom of mental health problems like anxiety, depression, grief, stress, and so on. Furthermore, lots of physical medical conditions also cause tiredness. So unrelieved exhaustion may be related to liver failure, anemia, cancer, chronic kidney disease, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, that's smoking-related lung disease, heart disease, hypothyroidism, so high and low thyroid can cause tiredness. Lots of medications like medications for high blood pressure and antidepressants can cause tiredness. Obesity can cause tiredness, restless leg syndrome can cause tiredness, sleep apnea can cause tiredness, and diabetes can cause tiredness.
So there's an awful lot of things that can make you feel tired, and thank you very much to the Mayo Clinic for enumerating that massive list of things. When we're talking about chronic fatigue syndrome, though, we're typically talking about prolonged tiredness that doesn't have an obvious cause like this, right? So usually when people are diagnosed with CFS-ME, they've already been through that great big list of factors and others with their doctor to exclude these kind of known causes of tiredness. That is, the CFS-ME is what we think of as an idiopathic disease. That is, a disease that doesn't have a known cause. Now, idiopathic diseases are really philosophically interesting, I think. But I'll skip that for the time being and just note that there are an awful lot of names that have been given to various kinds of idiopathic, unknown cause, chronic fatigue. Fibricular, neurasthenia, DaCosta syndrome, chronic brucellosis, chronic hypoglycemia, total allergy syndrome, chronic candidiasis, and chronic Epstein-Barr infection are just some of the ones that I managed to find while doing some research on this. Those actual particular names might sound a bit odd in a list of idiopathic diseases now those actual names might sound a bit peculiar in a list of things that are supposed to be idiopathic. A lot of those sound very causy, right, like chronic Epstein-Barr infection. Something then that's worth noting is that these labels were introduced kind of in the absence of strong evidence that the purported entity actually caused the tiredness, right? So the kind of people with... So a good example of the chronic hypoglycemia. So a good example is chronic hypoglycemia, where actually it seemed quite hard to demonstrate long-running low blood sugar in people who were suffering tiredness and were being diagnosed with this kind of thing. They weren't very well worked out kind of causal situations. I want to concentrate here, though, on two labels that were given to idiopathic long-lasting chronic fatigue. And these are CFS, chronic fatigue syndrome, and ME, myalgic encephalomyelitis. Now, CFS was introduced in the late 1980s. And it was introduced as a neutral and inclusive way of describing long-lasting chronic fatigue. Now, I'm not convinced, really, that this term is completely neutral, in that built into this kind of the definition of CFS is a de-emphasis on some kind of organic cause, right? It's meant largely to be a diagnosis of exclusion. Now, the other term that we're going to be talking about, ME, really rejects this kind of way of thinking. It's a strong, as the name suggests, myalgic, it's a painful, encephalomyelitis, is a strongly kind of biological way of thinking about chronic fatigue. And it's the kind of, it's the comparison of these two that I want to concentrate on for the rest of this lecture, really. So CFS was introduced as a kind of way of thinking about chronic fatigue that tended to de-emphasize biological causes. We can look at the Centre for Disease Control 2011 criteria that are used for diagnosis, and these give a nice example of this kind of sort of non-bio way of thinking. So it's a debilitating and complex disorder characterized by intense fatigue that's not improved by bed rest and that may be worsened by physical activity or mental exertion. Now, that's quite unusual for most kinds of chronic fatigue, which tend to be improved by some kind of limited physical activity. Actually, that kind of claim for chronic fatigue syndrome is really controversial at the moment, because there's a kind of ongoing dispute going on about a large trial that was partly about graded exercise therapy. This is the PACE trial, and we'll discuss this a bit more in the seminars. Anyway, back to the definition. People with CFS often function at a substantially lower level of activity than they were capable of before they became ill. So it's disabling. And the cause or causes of CFS have not been identified, and no specific diagnostic tests are available. Therefore, a CFS diagnosis requires three criteria. We can have a look at these criteria, which are quite complicated, so I will just try and zoom through again. But first of all, you've got to have had severe chronic fatigue for 6 or more consecutive months. Okay, so this is not the kind of thing that you could be really diagnosed with if you had occasional bouts of fatigue caused by, say, poor planning of journeys by public transport. You have to have severe chronic fatigue for 6 or more months, and it's not due to ongoing exertion or other medical conditions associated with fatigue. So you need to go and rule out, you know, among other things, that great long list of things that we looked at earlier. Second of all, the fatigue has to interfere with your activities of daily living and your work. Third of all, you have to have at least 4 of the following list of symptoms. You have to have post-exertional malaise or unrefreshing sleep or significant impairment of memory or concentration or muscle pain, or pain in the joints or headache or lymphadenopathy or a recurring sore throat. Now, at this point, I kind of want to pause and just kind of speculate here about the kind of idea that this is a non-biological kind of condition. That a lot of these kind of factors sound extremely physical illness-y to me. I'm not an expert, of course. But things like joint pains and muscle pains and headaches and lymphadenopathy sound pretty bio, right? And it's important to note that the symptoms should have been persistent or recurrent over months. That is, that they have to kind of co-travel with the fatigue itself. And I think this is to rule out kind of cases where people get ill with something and then get a sort of post-illness fatigue state. Those are quite common, as we'll go on to see. Anyway, so an important part of this kind of definition of CFS is the way that it overlaps with other kinds of prolonged fatigue. And actually, there's this nice kind of diagram that comes from Foucault's framework, which gives you a nice kind of diagram of how different kinds of chronic fatigue states are supposed to relate to one another. I think that's enough on as an introduction to CFS. So maybe we can jump and think about ME instead, myalgic encephalomyelitis. I promise you I will say that properly once at least by the end of this video. So let's have a look at a kind of introductory case to think about ME. And remembering that ME is supposed to be a more biological way of explaining prolonged fatigue. So this is from an article by David Wesley and Pelosi, and note that that's Simon Wesley again, who we've already mentioned a couple of times, particularly when we talked about the definition of CFS stroke ME. So ME continues to provoke strong interest in the medical press and intense interest in the lay media. The condition, variously named, and here we go again with the long names, epidemic neuromyasthenia, Icelandic disease, benign myalgic encephalomyelitis, Royal Free Disease, and epidemic myalgic encephalomyelitis, is more appropriately referred to as the post-viral fatigue syndrome. Clinical descriptions include a vast array of symptoms and signs, but the two main features that emerge are fatigue and emotional disturbance. Now, the point here is that these authors are identifying ME as being a kind of post-viral fatigue syndrome. These are relatively common. As anyone who's been unfortunate enough to have glandular fever or mono will tell you. What might be a bit less familiar, though, are some of these other diseases that ME is co-identified with. And I want to talk about one of these, which is Royal Free Disease. Now, the case of Royal Free Disease is a really, really fascinating one. Let me put up this graph here for a second. So, during 1955, the Royal Free Hospital in North London was shut. And it was shut to new patients for nearly 3 months between late July and early October 1955. Now, the reason it was shut was because of an outbreak of some new illness that affected exclusively the medical staff in this establishment. Now, this is a graph of the number of cases affected at various points during this late summer and early autumn period. And as you can see, if we look at, so each one of these bars represents 1 week. And the very longest bar is up to about, 42 cases, something like that. So between something like 5 or 6 and 40 odd cases a week within the 1,000 or so medical staff at the Royal Free. So this is kind of an interesting example of an outbreak, I think. And the disease that they were suffering from seemed, extremely biological. There was objective evidence of affectation of the central nervous system, and the neurological manifestations formed a characteristic picture that distinguishes this disease from other infections of the nervous system. This is from the report written by the Royal Free medical staff a year or so after the outbreak, medical staff 1957. And in fact, a complex series of neurological features were found in something like 3/4 of those affected. That is, out of the almost 300 cases from the 3,500 medical staff. And these features were, very neurological looking. So, I mean, actually, if you look through the report, there are things like specific cranial nerve lesions, confusion, and so on and so on and so on. So at this point, in the mid-1950s, this disease looked very biological indeed. Now, I think at this point, it might be worth thinking about Hansen again and regard these kind of features from the Royal Free outbreak as being some surprising phenomena. Now, I think we could think of at least two different hypotheses that might explain this outbreak. First and most obvious is that because of the shared neurological features in this outbreak, and I suppose also the kind of distribution where it builds up and then where it sort of waxes and then wanes, we might think of this as something like an outbreak of a viral infection. On the other hand, not all the features of the outbreak were consistent with it being a viral infection. Most obviously and startlingly, none of the patients were affected. And now I think that's really remarkable. I mean, that's really something I think that you wouldn't expect to find if this were an infection, right? What are the chances that out of the thousands of patients who were in the hospital, despite it being close to new admissions, right, there were still large numbers of patients in the hospital. I think you really expect to find some cases in the patient population. After all, they're already, in general, ill, and you would suspect more rather than less susceptible to picking up some infection that was floating around and, you know, affecting something like 10% of the medical staff. So one reason for this given is that perhaps this was something like mass hysteria. Now, I'm not an expert in the terminology here, and I know that this is kind of disputed ground too, so I'll excuse myself. But the idea is that perhaps this is something that's spreading through psychological means in some way between the medical staff. Maybe it's something hysterical, right? Now, what we could do is we could use Hansen and compare these two hypotheses, right? So one hypothesis would be a viral infection, the other would be a mass hysteria. Our set of phenomena will be the same, and then we could compare our two hypotheses with respect to these phenomena. And what we find actually is that there's an interestingly disputed picture that emerges. And in fact, even using these kind of logical tools, it's not very clear which one of these two very different hypotheses we should prefer. So on the one side, on the viral infection side, we would see that a viral infection would very nicely explain the kind of neurological manifestations. But it would be much harder, I think, given current kind of background knowledge about how infections work, to explain why this disorder was patient sparing, unless we had some very specific kind of mechanism in place, like a mechanism of transmission that was, say, not accessible to patients, you know, something in the staff-only areas of the hospital that was acting as a reservoir of infection, for example. On the other hand, if we take the kind of mass hysteria route, we can very well explain this peculiar kind of epidemiological facet. So we could maybe explain why patients didn't seem to be coming down with this disease. But then I think it would be quite hard for us to explain why the neurology happened as it did. In some ways, this dispute about causation relating to the Royal Free outbreak mirrors what's going on in a much broader way between these two ways of thinking about CFS stroke ME. Right, on the one hand, you have this very biological model, ME, and there the emphasis is on investigating the kind of biological features, and particularly things that you find in the CFS stroke ME definitions, like, you know, specific sets of physical symptoms and signs. And on the other, this much more psychological model that tends to align with thinking about chronic fatigue syndrome, CFS. And it's worth noting from Sharp's review of this that there are very strong preferences in different groups. So most research literature tends to talk about CFS, chronic fatigue syndrome, that's the non-biological one, whereas patient organisations typically prefer ME, that's the biological one. And these very and the kind of differences that go along with using those differences, those different bits of terminology, really have led to some great difficulties in understanding what exactly it is that's being dealt with here. So, for example, you find some quite remarkable kind of sort of findings, like only something like 15% of neurologists, for example, recognised CFS as being some kind of neurological disorder. And we know that other medical practitioners find making diagnoses in this field very difficult. So Bowen suggests that something like half of GPs in the UK were not at all confident in making a diagnosis of CFS. So, to cut to the chase then, is CFS stroke ME a disease? More narrowly, if it is a disease, which one of these two different models should we prefer? Is CFS roughly right, the idea that it's a chronic, largely psychological condition? And should that be the kind of way that we understand this very serious and common kind of chronic fatigue? Or is the more biological ME the way to go? And is this something that would benefit from being thought of broadly as being a neurological condition, possibly, you know, related in some way to an infection or similar? I'm going to leave that hanging, because that kind of work is, I think, exactly what we'd like the philosophical literature on definitions of disease to help us do. Okay, thanks for that. Lots and lots of information in that one. I'd be very, very pleased indeed to see any questions or comments that you might have. But until next time, thanks a lot. I've been Brendan Clark, and this has been Lecture 5, Philosophy of Medicine from UCL STS. Thanks, bye.